Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me? Good evening. So the service isn't starting quite yet, but what we're going to do, we're going to sing a few pieces together as our pre-service praise. So you can remain seated for this opening section of praise. Although maybe the third piece, which will be the doxology going in praise to the Lord, we maybe would want to stand for that particular piece. But for the first couple, please remain seated. And if you know the pieces, feel free to join in. So we're going to sing 10,000 Reasons, This Is Amazing Grace, and then the doxology going in to praise to the Lord.
Oh, Stand.
Raise him, O Christ.
Well, we hope very much that singing at the beginning to set the tone for this special praise evening here in Derramore. There's lots of familiar faces here, but I can also see we have some visitors, and you're especially welcome here this evening, and we trust that we will know God's blessing as we worship him this evening. Just a couple of announcements, just to say that our offering this evening will go to the work of Christian Aid. And after the service concludes, we hope you'll not rush away, because I know the ladies and maybe even a few of the men have been involved in preparing a supper for tonight. So please stay and enjoy that, and enjoy a time of fellowship. Let's pray together. Loving God, we praise you and thank you that we can gather here this evening. And Lord, you are worthy of our praises because you have done so much for us in Christ. And so we come with hearts full of gladness and thanksgiving. And we pray that through this service tonight, our Savior will be honored and glorified. And we will be blessed to have been here, to have enjoyed the fellowship, and have been part of this special praise evening. So we commit ourselves in this service to you now, and pray that our Lord will be glorified through it all. For it's in his name we ask it. Amen. The choir, of course, has been busy preparing for this evening, and they're going to sing the first of three pieces that they're singing this evening. This one's entitled, Because He Lives. We're delighted to have our own Brian Rankin with us this evening to share two pieces of spoken prose. So I'm going to invite Brian now to come to deliver the first of those, which is entitled, Where Would I Have Stood?
I remember, as a wee boy, being fascinated with this film we watched on TV. It was called The Time Machine, I think. And I can remember it as so well, the man climbing into this complicated-looking contraption, strapped himself in, and there was a place where you could put in the date and the location you wanted to go to. And then he moved a big lever, and there was things started to spin around. There were lights started to flash. The noise got louder and louder until finally, poof, he was away to his new destination. Well, here's the question. If there was such a machine and you had a ticket, what date and what location would you select? I wonder what AD 31 in a place called Galilee would be like. And I suppose I wonder, how would I react when I got there? Or more specifically, where would I have stood? I wonder if I could go back to ancient Galilee. Where would I have stood in the crowd watching Jesus by the sea? Maybe I would have had no interest and stood right at the back, just out for the day with my friends, just there for a bit of crack, wondering what all the fuss was about, rumors of miracle cures, and fed up rubbing shoulders with the beggars, the lame, the poor. Or would I have been slightly closer, undecided and bemused, not sure if he was fake or not, feeling a bit confused? Maybe I'd be standing there hungry, sort of hoping to get fed, because I heard a big crowd yesterday got their fill of fish and bread. Or would I have stood in the middle with some ache or pain, too shy to ask for healing today, but I might come back again? Maybe I had went there all curious, thinking it would do no harm, and found my stone-cold skeptic heart start to turn lukewarm. Or would I have moved closer still, convinced by his behavior that this could be the Son of God, that this could be the Savior? Or maybe I'd have stood right at the front, there for Jesus to see, standing beside James and John, wishing he had picked me. Would I be hanging on his every word, watching him as he spoke? Would it all be so clear to me, like from a dream I'd woke? I wonder if I could go back and hear it all firsthand. Where would I have stood in the crowd on that Galilean sand? And then I realize with a jolt that Jesus has not gone away. So I suppose I have to ask myself, where do I stand today?
We're very blessed here in Derramore to have many talented people, among those many talented singers, and four of them are going to come to the platform now. The quartet are going to sing a piece entitled All Praise to Him. I'd invite you all to stand for our next praise, which is Christ, our hope in life and death. and sing a piece we all know, and this is her version of What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Hello. Let me just tune this, because if it goes wrong, it sounds horrible. Jangliness will be characterful. This is my dad's favourite hymn, and it means a great deal to me, and I hope it does to you as well.
We're going to continue to worship the Lord now as we present our offering. Let's join together in prayer. Let's pray. Lord, we praise you for the many ways you provide for us, but we confess that we often take your goodness for granted. Forgive us for those times when we fail to acknowledge your provision and make us more mindful of the needs of others. We thank you for the opportunity to support others in need of help through this offering that we present now. And as we do, we pray for the good work done by Christian Aid to alleviate the suffering of many. With soaring costs affecting people all around the world, we're thankful for this opportunity to show a compassionate response to those in the greatest need. We remember in particular the situation in Malawi, where families are paying the price of the current global crisis, with food, fuel, fertilizer, and school fees doubling in price over the last 12 months. Hardworking farmers are seeing their harvests fail as the climate crisis brings increasingly erratic weather. In addition, the impact of the recent Cyclone Freddy in Malawi has been devastating. Floods have washed away crops. Over 500,000 people have been displaced, and hundreds have lost their lives. Father, with all that in mind, it is our prayer tonight that our monetary gifts, along with our prayers, will go some way to helping families rebuild their lives, giving them hope for the future. And all this we ask in our Saviour's name. Amen. The choir are now going to sing a piece entitled Dig a Little Deeper.
Thank you.
I'm going to invite Brian back now to recite a piece entitled The Four of Us.
I wrote this poem a few months ago, and I suppose it's based on these words that we find in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 2. When Jesus returned to Capernaum several days later, the news spread quickly that he was back home. Soon the house where he was staying was so packed with visitors that there was no more room even outside the door. While he was preaching God's word to them, four men arrived, carrying a paralyzed man on a mat. They couldn't bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, so they dug a hole in the roof above his head. Then they lowered the man on his mat right down in front of Jesus. The four of us. It was because of friendship the four of us carried that day. Our lifelong friend, a cripple, helpless on the stretcher lay. We had to get him to Jesus, for if the stories were true, there was just no limit to his power. Nothing he couldn't do. For 2 days, our village was on fire with talk of miracle cures. Everyone wanted to meet him, the deaf blind, the rich, the poor. Our shoulders ached, our hands were raw, but we kept pressing on. Rumors that this was his last day here, and soon he would be gone. We'd hatched our plan the night before. We'd hardly slept a wink. But when we finally got to the house, boys, our hearts did sink. The crowds, the street was full. But no giving up this time. We went round the back, found some steps, and we began to climb. We finally made it to the roof thatch, urged on by our stricken friend. We made a neat hole between the rafters, one we could easily mend. He was smiling as we lowered him, our hands burning with the rope, a look on his face I'd never seen before. I think it was a thing called hope. Disciples' hands received him gently. Thank goodness, for we were beat. Then a few kind words from Jesus, and our man jumped to his feet. Oh, this had to be the Son of God. We had just seen the proof. We hugged each other, tears in our eyes. We danced upon that roof. Aye, it was because of friendship the four of us carried that day. But it was because of the Savior. Five of us walked away.
Thank you so much, Brian, for both those pieces you shared with us this evening. It certainly enhanced our time together. We're all going to stand again to sing this time the piece entitled My Soul Will Await. going to invite Laura to come now and read for us from God's Word. And Laura's reading from Psalm 84.
Psalm 84. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may have her young, a place near your altar. Lord Almighty, my King and my God, blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The autumn rains also cover it with pools. They go from strength to strength till each appears before God in Zion. Hear my prayer, Lord God Almighty. Listen to me, God of Jacob. Look on our shield, O God. Look with favor on your anointed one. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk is blameless. Lord Almighty, blessed is the one who trusts in you.
Thank you, Laura. I'm going to invite Chris and Claire now to sing a piece entitled, He Will Hold Me Fast.
My faith will fail. Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. He saves are his delight. Christ will hold me fast. Precious in his holy sight, he will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last. But by him at such a cost, he will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. Died. Christ will hold me fast. Just
your behalf, can I thank everyone who has taken part in the service tonight through word and song. It really has been a blessing, and we hope that you have all enjoyed it, and in some way we've all been touched by God's grace through our singing and reading this evening. Turning to the reading that Laura read for us from the Psalms, Psalm 84, just a short reflection on that psalm. In the introduction to his commentary on Psalm 84, Owen Palmer Robertson says, "The message of Psalm 84 is about the yearning of the heart of God's people for fellowship with him. They have an unquenchable thirst to be in God's house so they can know him as a friend and be assured of his blessing on their lives. The psalmist understands that God especially blesses all those who come to fellowship in his house." In this psalm, we see three blessings that will be experienced by those who worship God in his house. The blessing of being in God's house, the blessing of traveling to God's house, and the blessing of trusting in God, the God who meets you there. The psalmist begins by expressing the desire that draws him to the house of the Lord. He says in the opening verses, "How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God." Here the writer is trying to describe how much he loves God's house, his dwelling place. The house of God in the Old Testament was the temple that Solomon built. It was the prescribed place where all in Israel and converts from beyond its borders were to come for worship and fellowship with the living God. In the New Testament, God's dwelling is not located in any particular place on earth, but there are clear statements in the Bible about how we can connect with God. "God is spirit," said Jesus, "and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth," John 4, verse 24. In other words, the only way that we can really connect with God is on a spiritual level and on the basis of the truth of who he is and what he's done for us, as revealed in his word and is conveyed to us by his spirit. Today, God's temple is located wherever God's people as individuals and a group are to be found, and the New Testament affirms this. In his first letter to the Corinthians, the Apostle Paul wrote, "Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God?" And to the Ephesians, he says, "In Christ Jesus, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit." We often refer to the church as a building, but from a biblical point of view, the church with a capital C is wherever God's people are. As the psalmist penned Psalm 84, his mind was very much on God's dwelling place, the temple. But through faith in God's chosen one, that is Jesus Christ, he comes to live within us by his Spirit. And he lives by his Spirit within us collectively when we gather as a congregation of his people, such as tonight. When we attend a church service, we all have expectations. The psalmist saw God's house as a place of peace and security, and he used the metaphor of birds to make his point. In verse 3, he says, "Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may have her young, a place near your altar, O Lord Almighty, my King and my God." The image here is of a mother bird soaring through the sky, looking for a place of rest where she may build her nest. She seeks a place of solitude and peace where she can lay her eggs, where she can see her young mature without fear of disturbance. Where will she find the place of security she longs for? Well, she spots the brazen altar of Almighty God, and there at the point of sacrifice is the place of peace. At Solomon's temple in Jerusalem, the altar of brass stood out as the most prominent structure in the temple area. This is where large bulls were sacrificed for the sins of the people, the priest placing his hands on the animal to symbolize the transmission of the people's guilt to the substitutionary sacrifice. The animal was slain on the altar, and so peace was made. According to the psalmist's analogy, with the sacrifice having been made and peace established, the birds of the air can now make their nests in the assurance that they won't be disturbed. Of course, such sacrifices could not remove the guilt and punishment that mankind deserves. They only existed for a time, and they pointed to the sacrifice that God's Son would make on Calvary's cross. The psalmist understood what a blessing it was to be in God's house, and he was in no doubt about the benefits of being in the place of worship. In verse 4, he says, "Blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you." And we have much to praise God for, don't we? The psalmist then turns his attention to the blessing of traveling to God's house. Now, he's not referring to the journey that people make to get to a church service, but rather he's drawing a comparison between the pilgrimage of the Israelites to Jerusalem and the larger pilgrimage of life to the heavenly house of God that will be inhabited forever. In verse 5, he says, "Blessed are those whose strength is in you, who have set their hearts on pilgrimage." In addition to the weekly Sabbath, three times a year, the males and often the whole family made the long trek to Jerusalem. There they would spend a week or more worshiping God, morning and evening. And no doubt they felt blessed as they anticipated this annual trip. As an alternative translation of this verse puts it, "How blessed are those in whose heart is the highway to your house." They would have loved even the prospect of traveling along the road that led to their spiritual capital. Life is a journey. We all know that. And it can get a bit bumpy at times. And the psalmist seems to allude to this in verse 6, where he says, "As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The autumn rains also cover it with pools." The valley of Baca means the valley of weeping or the valley of tears. This was a place that the Israelites passed through on their way to Jerusalem. And as we make our way through life, more than once we will pass through a valley of tears, metaphorically speaking. And it's at such times that our faith may be tested the most, and certainly the Israelites would have been tested as they journeyed to Jerusalem. If we struggle to understand what's meant by the phrase, "they make it a place of springs," then the authorized King James Version is helpful, because there it says that those who pass through the valley of Baca make it a well. In the midst of the worst conditions, they are to do what they can to receive God's blessing. They are to make a well in readiness to receive water from the springs and the autumn showers. From this, we can understand that it's possible for a place of sorrow to become a place of blessing. As the Israelites encountered difficulties as they made their way to Jerusalem, they looked to God and allowed him to turn their troubles into blessings as only he can. So whatever troubles you or I may be going through just now, God wants us to know that he can send showers of blessing to sustain us. And just as his people pass through the valley of Baca, so he will bring us through our valley of tears. The key is to trust in him and to live in obedience to him, surrendering our valley experiences to him. As the Israelites neared Jerusalem, there would have been an increasing sense of anticipation of the fellowship that they would experience there. And in a similar way, we as God's people today should have a sense of expectation as we journey through life towards our eternal home. Just as the ancient pilgrims were assured that they would appear before God in Zion, we have the assurance that we will one day appear before him in heaven. There's blessing in being in God's house. There's blessing in traveling to God's house. And finally, there's blessing, the blessing of trusting the God who meets us there. If you'd been an Israelite attending worship, your attention would have been focused on two people who'd been anointed by God, the king and the high priest. The psalmist recognizes the central role they played in worship. When in his prayer, in verse 9, he says, "Look upon our shield, O God. Look with favor on your anointed one." Now, there's no way of telling if the psalmist was referring to the priest or the king, who were both anointed by the Lord. But from a New Testament perspective, it's very clear that God's anointed one is his son, Jesus Christ, who fulfilled the roles of both priest and king, living among us so that he might provide a way of access to God, establishing God's kingly rule, and now ruling at the Father's right hand, where he fulfills the role of high priest as he intercedes for us. If we are truly God's people, we'll be attracted to the place of worship. We want to be in his house. As the psalmist says in verse 10, "Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked." I trust that this brief reflection on Psalm 84 tonight has been helpful. It's a psalm that reminds us that there are blessings that come when we put God first and make it our goal to worship him. There's the blessing of being in God's house, the blessing of traveling to God's house, and there's the blessing of trusting the God who we meet there. And the psalmist concludes by pointing out just how great is the blessing for those who put their trust in God. He says in verse 11, "No good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless. O Lord Almighty, blessed is the man who trusts in you." Folks, if you have heard God speaking to you tonight, I trust that you will make it your goal to be in God's house, the place of worship. Follow God's path for your life, allowing him to guide you, and trust in the one who will one day welcome you into that heavenly home he's preparing for you. Amen. I'm going to invite the choir to come and sing their final piece this evening, "It Is Well With My Soul." We're going to stand now and sing our closing praise, "How Great Thou Art."
Oh,
What a wonderful way to end our praise evening. Thank you so much for being here. We really do hope that you will want to stay and enjoy some of the lovely supper that the ladies have been prepared. I will pronounce the benediction in a moment, but after I do that, could I ask the folks who have been seated in the walkways, if you perhaps were to leave first, that might make it easier for others to get out. But we hope that many of you will want to stay. I'm not going to go to the door because it would take a long time for you all to filter past me, but hopefully I'll get speaking to some of you through in the hall in a few minutes' time. We close with a benediction. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us this night and remain with us always. Amen. Amen.